honor to be here with all of you. Thank you for being here for one of the last presentations. I like to teach you through dialogue, and actually, I'm going to say something to all of you. I'm going to share a really special moment with you because I'm getting ready to defend my dissertation in the next few weeks, and this is article number 2 out of 3 of my standing dissertation. So I want to start off with a question before I go through the presentation, and I don't want to do this traditionally, like we're here to learn together, so you may even help me build on this. So any questions that come up or something you think I could add onto it, I'd appreciate it, you know, that's what this is about. But before we start, how do we know what the other is in your mind? Like when you come into a classroom, when you go into a school, who's the other? According to your values, your beliefs, anybody, just throw it out there.
Me. I remember when I was in high school, and I was all African American, and my honors and AP classes, so it was me.
And you felt like you were the other.
I was the other.
You were the other.
Yeah, they made me feel like I was the other.
How'd they make you feel like you were the other?
I was gonna talk about this later, but I distinctly remember when I was in the 5th grade, I moved from Henrico County, which is here, right outside of Richmond, predominantly African American jurisdiction, to Chesterfield County. My parents lived in Brandonville, which is an affluent neighborhood. Back in the late, well, I can know, early 80s. When I was escorted to my homeroom classroom that first day of school, you could hear all this noise, but as soon as they opened the door, you could hear a pin drop.
Wow.
And I remember that.
Thank you for sharing that. Anybody else over here? What's the other to you?
Anything that's not white, male, Christian, like to me, is like, I fall within that, but especially when you're reading a book or whatever, it's always assumed that the voice of the author is going to be white, male, and Christian, which is a, like, dominant.
Okay, so a dominant view that excludes other ones.
Yeah.
Okay, so the title of this, my second article is titled Slipping into Darkness and Ideological Tracking of the Other. The importance of critical reflection in teaching pedagogical practices. So what happens when we slip into darkness? I was bumping a song by War earlier because it's what motivated me. It was a song I listened to in my youth. We don't have clarity, right? We don't have clarity, so we don't have clarity, we're more cautious. So what does it mean when we track somebody? Anybody, what does it mean to track? Track someone. Imagine tracking someone's behavior.
Follow.
Observing.
Follow.
Okay, follow. Follow based on what do you think? What could you possibly follow based upon what?
Their behaviors.
Behavior how?
The places they go to is how I follow them. If I know they always go in this direction of the woods, I'd go to that direction of the woods to track them.
Okay, cool. Okay, let's start. Now, any ideas? I want you to jump in, okay? So, what is the purpose of this study? So, research has actually theorized that teachers' views in relation to the early socialization, how they're brought up, through religion, through family values, through norms, right? They actually influence how they think, how they view who comes through that door into an area of confinement like ours right now. How do they view them? What's usually neglected, right, from such research in the art of teaching, the art of aprendizaje, to learn, right? How do such ideologies influence teachers inside the classroom on the individual person based on difference? So, there's a critical scholar, Dana G. Oakes, in education, and she wrote this phenomenal book called Teaching Track, How Schools Segregate Children, something like that. Don't quote me, I'm paraphrasing it. So tracking demonstrates, right, the students are funneled into particular classes based on the socioeconomic status, where they're from, where their parents are from. What this does is it reproduces social inequity. Usually the students who are viewed as less competent, less able, are put in classes, less achievement. That's what's actually viewed of them, that's what's actually perceived of them. It has detrimental consequences. So, I'm gonna start on this premise. Less research has been performed detailing how ideological tracking is enacted within the classroom content and how such ideologies are sustained by the influence of early socialization and the reproduction of consciousness in the classroom. The classroom is not neutral, right? If we look at the work of Foucault, right? It's an apparatus of intensification in a classroom. What is the difference between coming into a classroom? Feeling, think about the feeling when that door closes. Any of you all been in a jail? There's not much of a difference the way it feels. I mean, obviously we know we can get out whenever we want, but you're stuck in here. And what does that do to the human psyche? Is that really the way we should learn? And that's what I want you to start thinking of as I go through this presentation, because we're not dreaming, of what school should look like in the next 200 years when we're way out of here? Is it really affected the way we are right now? What we call the structure of schooling, right? The history of it. So introduction. So research on the socio-historic experiences of socially marginalized and racialized communities shows them that they're at a disadvantage. A disadvantage in relation to education, to housing, to employment. In such lived realities, usually people from lower socioeconomic class, right? People that live in impoverished communities, they don't have a symbolic capital. At least that's how it's interpreted. We don't have a symbolic capital to navigate through those arenas to achieve social mobility, right? That's an ideology. That's an ideology of difference and an ideology of the other. And it continues to basically saturate the master narrative in education. So, as I was reflecting, I used what's called friendship as a methodology. And I was in Tucson, Arizona, and I got there in 2013 under some very painful circumstances. And I wanted to know how can I make a change with my research? And I'm only gonna get one shot at this PhD thing, you know. Remind me to tell you the PhD story after the presentation. How can I make a difference? How can I make a difference with my research? How can I make change? So I used friendship as a methodology, and I went to one of the high schools that had been banned, and I extended my hand, and I was like, how can my research help? What can I do to make a difference here in Arizona with what I'm doing? And the principal was like, well, we can't get teachers to change their ways of thinking. I was like, well, I don't think I can make them change it, but I can be a voice for it. I go, let's interrogate it. So I applied all the research that I had done on social class, on tracking, on surveillance, and I created these three questions for this particular article. It was, what do teachers perceive to be the role when educating lower performing students? So how do they feel? What should they do when they work in, you know, historically marginalized communities? Can you tell me about how you teach diverse students here at Vigilancia High School? Vigilancia means surveillance school. How do you identify students that are struggling, and what do you do? So how do I get theoretical with this? So I wanted to use a socio-historical analysis. Socio-historical analysis comes from this Russian brother named Lev Vygotsky, and he actually started off with social-cultural theory first. The socio-historical theory states this: all our interpersonal interactions, every way we interact with each other, is attached, right, to history and to culture, right? So there's a reproduction there of how we end up mediating our understanding of the world that we live in. Right, and we have to be conscious of that at all times, because these are not neutral places. Right, there's a reproduction of these ideas, a reproduction of how we're made to feel, and how we're made to think. So, the importance of high school, right? According to research, different distributed to social class during high school experience a focal point in the lives of youth. This is basically when we break off. Either you make it or you don't. What are the consequences of not finishing high school? What are the consequences of it? Anybody, hit me. What happens?
Low-paying job.
Low-paying jobs, right? How about the stigma of a high school dropout? What does that do to a person? I mean, I'm sure we know people that have been pushed out of high school, because it's not a high school dropout. You're pushed out when a school fails to be responsive to your needs, to your community needs. So what are those stigmas that happen, right? So very focal point on what happens, and it was gonna be very personal to me as well, and I'll talk about it in a minute, why it was important to focus on high school. So, when structures of schooling operate within the confinements of a capitalist society, they need to reproduce a labor force. They reproduce a labor force, and it's based on social stratification. How do we stratify society? So I asked a little bit ago, what happens when you're perceived as a quote-unquote high school dropout? What are your chances of social mobility, right? So how do we weed people out? You know, think about No Child Left Behind, Race to the Top. But this has been theorized in the past. How we socialize youth in a culture of schooling, right, is what Foucault and Ball talked about, for example. It's a message of correct training. For example, I'm up here right now and I'm sweating bullets, okay? I really am, right? Am I talking right? Am I running over my words? Am I tripping over my words? Right? Because we're made to feel inferior at a young age. Our culture is made to make you feel inferior. The way we talk is made to feel inferior. The way we act, the way we carry ourselves It's not the master narrative like my sister said over here. It's not, right? So correct training and productivity. You gotta be specific how you do things, how you say things, but you gotta be quick at doing it too. And if that doesn't happen, if you can't test quick, if you can't write quick, if you can't communicate quick, what happens? You're exiled out of education. So this is something that happens to many of us. My sister mentioned it a little bit ago, right? How you're made to feel when you walk into that door, right? Working class support family are really excluded from participation in high power group, right? Because our way of living, our funds of knowledge, our understanding of the world is not valued into the mainstream educational system. It continues to be excluded. That's what we continue to fight for, particularly in the field of ethnic studies. So what were my methods and data? I took a feminist approach to my research. This came out to be a qualitative case study. I conducted 22 semi-structured interviews with 17 high school students and 5 high school teachers. What I did during last February of 17 into May of 17, was I did 3 observations of 5 teachers in each session. I also used participant observation. I attended high school administrative meetings with parents and community members. And you know, I wanna just briefly mention something about this. To see people who claim, and I respect them, and I'm thankful that they let me do research in their school, but to see people who consider themselves critical educators and to reproduce ideas that you just couldn't imagine, to make a person feel, it's hard to talk about this, but I remember during the research, there was a mom that went in there and her kid, he was being disciplined. He was gonna get kicked out of school. And they just sat there and talked her down, okay? They told her how bad her kid was. He was in high school. They brought back his kindergarten grades, his first grade testing. And she starts crying. You know, she's in there dirty with her clothes dirty. And I couldn't help. I started crying. And I remember I got up after and I just gave her a hug. And I go, "You're a good mom for being here." But the reality of what you see when you immerse yourself in that kind of research. Something I want to be really clear about. When I engage my participants, and I am calling participants, my collaborators, my partners in the research, because that's how I saw everybody in that high school, I wanted to use pláticas. Pláticas have recently been adopted by Chicana feminists, and it's really important to use pláticas. I'm not saying a discussion. We're walking down the street and we're bullshitting. That's why I put explicit consonant in the beginning of the presentation. You have to have that trust with each other to talk about issues that are very delicate, because we try to use a structured approach to discussing issues. A lot of these people have been disciplined constantly. A lot of these people have had encounters with law enforcement. A lot of people, there's a lot of things that they go through that they get very, the social distance comes up really fast and they don't want to discuss it. So I like using pláticas. Pláticas are very important because it's communal and it's very family oriented as well. So I use that approach. All the pláticas and observations were documented by taking preliminary jottings and field notes. So my data analysis. The data was anchored, the study was anchored by implementing the feminist methodology of appreciative inquiry. Important in appreciative inquiry, right, is that it's non-exploitive, you know? You have to be real. Remember I said that earlier, you gotta be real about shit. I told them when I went in there, you know, I'm getting a PhD, you know what I'm saying? But I never finished high school. You know, I got thrown out like in 1993, like in my freshman year, I got 5 credits in high school, that's all I got. And then I got a GED years later. And here we are. So, you know, to sit in a math class in there and not understand what was going on in their school, like not understand, seeing that kids could do a lot more than I could do and being real about it, you know? Being real about it, you know, it changed the parameters and the hierarchy. So that was really important for me to do. Important in AI research, right? You look for information, right? Instead of trying to find it, okay? It's a communal effort and it's important to dismantle hierarchies. All tape recorded interviews are transcribed onto a Word doc and implemented. I used holistic coding because I wanted to preserve the words exactly as they were from the teacher to the students. A lot of times people try to pull stuff out that parallel to whatever the research questions are. I wanted to make sure either it's going to go or it's not going to go. So I wanted to be really clear what the word said from my partners in the research. So results. The analysis from the semi-structured interviews and pláticas identified 3 themes across the teacher participants. They were disengaging from the curriculum, diverse perspectives, and emotional attrition in teaching. How much time do I have? Am I doing good for time? Okay. So curriculum disengagement. The teacher I observed at Vigilanza High School, usually the classroom sizes were between 20 and 25 students. And what I saw constantly, the teacher trying to make an effort with, that's a big class, okay? And they were constantly trying to move, trying to engage the students because they understood that they would stop paying attention after a certain amount of time. And I want to talk about this, what this teacher said in particular. My maestra, I call her Lone Star, originally from Texas. She said, I asked her, why? How do you view different students? What's different to you? What's other to you? And she said this, they are not the kids who are out smoking weed. They have their excuses. They will tell you if they are cool with them. They will tell you, I just don't give a fuck. That's them. They are here. They are just not part of schooling. They are different because I can't read them. I don't know what is going on with them. Maybe they don't trust me because everybody else trusts me like the other 95% of the kids. Even if all they care about is sex and drugs, they will just be like, well, miss, I'm busy. You know, like they will tell me, they know that I am not judging them. They are like some kid that is the end of the year and I don't have a relationship with them. And I tried to feel different, but something is missing. What she attributed to the other, and I only took a little chunk of the data out because I didn't have room, but I wanted to make sure I had enough time to explain to you. Here was a middle class teacher, white middle class teacher, and she attributed other to black students that don't smile. Mm-hmm. Students that are sometimes dirty. That was her understanding of the other. And that's the one she felt she had to keep an eye on. What can that possibly transform into when you have those ideas or beliefs of students, right? She still tried her very best. I mean, she was trained, critically trained in education, critical multicultural education, to engage students from diverse communities, but she still had those views of the students in the class. I want you to think about that. Let it marinate. Diverse lived experiences. Some teachers suggested that it was important to welcome their students in the class, and here was a particular problem that I found that was upsetting. I almost dropped my bag of books. For example, this teacher, I mentioned a white middle class teacher, he said, I call him Maestro La Marina because he had a military background. He said, so in first and third grade, they would bus white kids over to the side of town, south side of Tucson, and then from fourth to sixth grade, they would bus minorities to that side of town, east side of Tucson, trying to equalize, they were trying. So I think, but we did recognize that there was a difference, right? Because those were the kids that took the bus. It wasn't necessarily that they were the black kids, but there was a correlation there. Pretty much most of the black kids in our school didn't live in the neighborhood. So his approach was this. I treat all my students the same. I am responsive to my students. I try to do the very best. I even had lunch with this guy, and the last day of research, he was yelling at a kid in the hallway, just getting in his face. Like, I couldn't believe it, like in his face. And I'm like, how are you responsive, man? You know, I was thinking I couldn't stay and actually confront him and talk to him about it, but I saw how he was yelling at one of his students. I'm like, how are you a culturally responsive student when you're in his face, like in his face, against the locker, like yelling at him? You're gonna get your shit together, you get the fuck out of my class. So, how do diverse lived experiences, what do we need to change? What do we need to further provide to break that social barrier, that social distance that we have in our understanding of what difference is? This was another example. And here's another concern. And I call that emotional attrition. Attrition usually comes from a word theory. But a lot of teachers, for example, felt completely exhausted from the students, from what they had to endure every single day in class, teaching the students. The patience, paciencia with the students. It was exhausting to them. For example, here was a teacher, and I remember her clearly, she was from Pennsylvania, from Pittsburgh, older woman, and I call her Maestra Hierro, Steel. She's like, yeah, like the other day a kid in the hall called me a fucking bitch. If you said that in my high school, you were gone. Oh my gosh, verbal attack was something that some of the teachers experienced often with students. Profanity was a common theme and something that was patrolled and disciplined among teachers. She flat out said, I don't trust students. I trust like two students in my class right now. That's it. I don't trust anybody else here. No confianza. Okay? So what does that do? How does that demarcate students from your teaching? How does that create a discipline in teaching? So, no trust. However, she did state this, I remember. She said, I could teach anywhere else in the city of Tucson, but I drive 45 minutes back and forth every day to teach these kids. So I care about these kids. I'll leave that up to you to think about, but that was specifically how she felt. But again, this is how they begin to see the other. I can't deal with your problems. I don't trust you. Another teacher said she couldn't handle students' problems, that she was there to teach, and sometimes she couldn't hear all the students' problems. Well, I would say this. If you're gonna teach, you have to have the heart to do it. It's not just a job. You know, you have to care about each and every one of your students, and you have to have love for your students. Am I running out of time? Okay, I'm gonna get done real quick. Okay, so conclusion real quick. The findings suggest that teachers identify students who are struggling primarily through disengagement of curriculum and not being able to connect with the students in an interpersonal level. Some of the teachers express heightened frustration in their ability to engage students with large classes, and this often signals a misunderstanding and a distance between student and teacher, teacher and student. And I want to leave you with this. This article may be interpreted as an attack against teachers. That's not my intention, right? Most of the teachers in this study tried, but there was clearly some gaps that needed to be addressed in how they viewed their students in the classroom, okay? Again, my research is a small case study. It's just a small sample, but I believe this. I think future research needs to illuminate more fully how the lived realities of teachers influence how they ideologically track the other under apparatus of intensification. When you come into a class, it's not easy. Right away, it intensifies, right? You have different emotions, you have different feelings, you have different experiences. What does that do to teachers, right? Teacher-student relationship. A second area for future research then would be to better understand how teachers can overcome emotional attrition within schools. That's it.